Lord Jesus, speak through your word. Speak in this moment. Be so clear as to be unmistakable. Lord Jesus, speak in a way that your people are blessed forever. Let me be a conduit as you reach your children with the greatest message ever shared. That there is a King who loved us so much that he laid down his glory, wrapped the mystery in flesh, lived a sinless life because I couldn't, died a sinner's death, and then rose an eternal King with all power in heaven and earth. Today we say thank you. Some of us will shout. Some of us may run. Some may dance. Some may sit there. But all of us will have to acknowledge that Jesus is Lord. Let this message honor you. Father, let it honor you and your son Jesus. Guide me, Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Will you do one more round of praise to God for all he's done for you? That was real regular. I said, give the Lord Jesus a praise for all done for you. Stacy, my brother, turn me up in these monitors. I read this scripture earlier, but now I want to read it again. Is that all right? You can find it in Luke 24, first verse. Luke 24, first verse. Now on the first day of the week, for those who don't know, Monday is not the first day of the week. Sunday is the first day of the week. For those who may have grown up in different religious expressions, there are some who say the Sabbath is on Saturday. Well, actually, it's not. It's sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. But if you were not invited to the law, why are you trying to keep the law? You're not an Israelite. God wasn't talking to you. We are grafted into the promise through faith in Jesus Christ. You couldn't keep the law if you tried. And many people still try. They try to help God save them by their behavior. Your behavior cannot save you. We are not talking about behavior modification. We're talking about soul restoration. It only happens through the blood of Jesus. Because every single human being you will ever see has sinned against God. Including your favorite grandmother, your most godly grandfather, or that saved auntie that doesn't even speak English. All she does is speak in tongues. She can't even speak regular language at the restaurant. Yes, may I take your order? I'm going to get an order of shayabashato with a side of imamamasa. And for a drink, I need the water of the word. Eba. Auntie, please. She wants the breadsticks and the soup and salad. With a side of the Alfredo sauce. Anybody know where I'm talking about? I mean, it smells like feet in there every time. But we yet go. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, let that baby cry. Don't take that baby out, please. I like the sound of the next generation. So many churches like, get that baby out of here. Why? It's human beings. They cry. Now, if he stink, take him out of here and change him and then bring him back on in here. People shouldn't be made to feel ashamed for regular things. Babies cry. Everybody don't have an Easter suit and a hat, but you got some clothes. Wear them. Because I can promise you, God doesn't care what you wear. He just cares about you. And I hope the church gets back to that message, but if they don't, we got it. Love Story got it. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing spices which they had prepared. This is very important. Women had a critical role in honoring the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was the women who got there first. I believe that was a prophetic indictment on scared men. Because Jesus poured his life into 12 men, but none of those men got there first. It was some prophetic women. In fact, the people who financed Jesus' ministry were wealthy women. Are there any wealthy women here on Resurrection Sunday? Let me tell you what wealthy is. Wealthy is saved, whole, discerning, spirit-led, spirit-filled, know who you are, know what you carry, and know how to handle it. I said 8 things, none of them had anything to do with money. Because if you think money makes you wealthy, you're already broke. I'm standing under a new oil, so I should have a new authority. It was the women that got there first. And I believe that they were of ethnic origin because they brought spices. And bring me that garlic powder over here and that Lowry seasoning salt. Give me some Zatarain's. I'm joking. Somebody's like, did he really bring some seasoning salt to the tomb? They actually brought spices to embalm him. There are some people who have brought some stuff thinking you still in the grave. They should have left that stuff in the car because you are not there. You are not back there. You're not in that dead moment. You're not in that dead relationship. You're not in that dead place. You have been raised with Christ Jesus. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, 2 men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and the third day rise again. On this Resurrection Sunday, I want to preach for a few minutes from the thought, the ground and the grave. For my first message as the senior pastor of Love Story Church, I'd like to share from the thought, the ground and the grave. You may be seated. It's staggering when you think about it. It's incomprehensible. It really defies description. I mean, really, who would die for people just in case they choose to repent? If I'm dying for you, I gotta know it's worth it. Jesus did not die ignorant of what his sacrifice would mean. He knew that people would not believe. He knew that people would still doubt. He knew that people would reject him even after he died and rose from the dead. He knew it, and he did it anyway because he was willing to be obedient to the Father, even to the point of death. Each one of you has come here this day, whether online, Love Story Online community. What up, y'all? What up, L? Love Story. Hey. Break yourself, fool. And to those who are here from this community, the upstate region, or who have traveled, come from hours and hours away, each one of you has come with a story. You arrived in this moment having lived a certain amount of days, some of them good, some of them bad, all of them written. So why Love Story Church? Because no matter what page you are on, your story has an ending that brings you to a future and a hope, an expected end. And it is my job and the job of this church to be a conduit for you and your family and your friends and your cousins and your enemies and the people that can't stand you to somehow come into a place where we can have real honest discussion about the personhood of Jesus, the preeminence of his power, and the soon positioning of him as he cracks the sky and comes back again at the last trumpet sounding. Jesus is coming back soon. If you haven't checked the news, Jesus is coming back soon. If you haven't checked the political arena, Jesus is coming soon. Bridges are collapsing, but there is one bridge that you can cross over that will not fail you. His name is Jesus, and his shoulders are broad. The Jesus of the Bible is a Jesus who understands you, who understands what it's like to be talked about, ridiculed, laughed at, lied on, hated on, smiled in his face, but they jealous of him the whole time. There are people with your bloodline that cheese in your face and don't really like you, and you still play along like you don't know, but you know, because you got the Holy Spirit on the inside. You've always been different. You've always stood out. You know how to handle situations. You can step into a boardroom and be corporate. How are you? Nice to meet you. But when it's time to turn up at the family reunion, you understand how to do that as well. And if somebody wants to test your boundaries, they will learn really quickly that don't let my education fool you. There's another part to me. I want to talk to real people who are in real need of a real Jesus in a real time. Let's get some ground rules for the next few minutes that we are together. I only want to lift up Jesus. And I only want you to lift up Jesus. And I want you to leave here knowing that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. There is no man with a microphone on the planet, no woman with a microphone on the planet. There is no conference you can go to, no place you can go. There's no counselor, no psychologist, no psychiatrist that can give you keys to eternal salvation. Eternal salvation comes only through the blood of Jesus, and only through the person of Jesus can you ever see the Father. Is everybody real clear on that? My son asked me a question yesterday. It was really deep. He said, Dad, do I have to respect people who have different beliefs than me? I said, yeah, you can respect them. You don't have to respect what they believe. Well, what do you mean, Pastor? That seems offensive. No, if you believe something demonic, I don't have to respect what you believe. I can respect that you're allowed to believe it. But I'm not gonna receive that. and we're not going to be able to hang out, because if you over here worshiping demons and burning sage, you're dealing with some spirits, and I don't want that on me. It's real quiet in here. So you had a strange dream. Don't go to the dream book. Go to his book. And it's no judgment, because the reality is we're human beings and we were raised a certain way. We were introduced to certain things and we did not raise ourselves. Most of us were raised a particular way, believing particular things. But however you arrived here today, for the one time in history, we're all on the same page. Do me a favor. Give a quick elbow and a love tap to about six people. Tell them we on the same page. All the way around you. Go ahead. All the way around you. Tell them we on the same. Put it in the chat feed. It's staggering to think about the level of commitment Jesus displayed. That's a love so incomprehensible that it lets you choose whether or not you want to be free. It's a love that lets you choose whether to stay in bondage or to walk into your new life. A love so incomprehensible, it lets you choose whether or not you want to be saved. God doesn't send you to hell. You send you to hell. I'm going to say that again. God has never sent anybody to hell. You send yourself to hell by rejecting Jesus. And for those who have heard incorrectly that hell is not a real place, I can assure you that it is. And first of all, even if you weren't sure whether or not it is, and you're like, well, you know, I don't do things I'm not sure about. Yes, you do. You pay car insurance. You may never have an accident, but just in case you do, you paid them premiums so that you can have the, call my people. I'm sorry I hit your car. Call Allstate. I wouldn't play games with my eternal soul. So just in case I'm right, you should get saved. So it was on Friday. Actually, you can start Thursday night, as Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, agonizing over the decision that he was about to make. And he says, Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Not my will, but your will be done. Jesus, who never hurt anybody, Jesus, who never disrespected anybody, Jesus, who all he did was love people, fight for people, free people, heal people, save people, open deaf ears, blinded eyes, stop issues of blood, interrupting funerals, whether it was the dead girl or Lazarus, these are the fruit of a man fully submitted to his Father. And then on the night where he needed his friends the most, they abandoned him. Have you ever felt abandoned? It's actually a question. I don't want you to, I'd like you to talk back. You can talk to me. Have you, I didn't say people left you, because there are people who will leave you. Hey, I'm getting ready to go to the store. I'll see you later. They left. They coming back. Abandoned? They were with you. You look around. You think they still there. They boned out. They left. Didn't call. Didn't write. Send no letter, no text. Gone. And what made the abandonment of Jesus worse is that he did everything right. And in the moment that he needed the men he had poured into the most, they were nowhere to be found. And he told them, he said, there's a moment coming when you will leave me all alone, yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. Peter talking all that smack. I ain't never leaving you. I never deny you. He said, shut up. Before the rooster crows, you will have denied me three times. Yeah, right. I doubt that. About 4 a.m. Never heard of him. You know Jesus? Nope. Don't know him. He even cussed a little girl out. Read the Bible. Started cussing at her. I don't know that so-and-so. I don't know him. Cock-a-doodle-doo. And in one of the scriptures, the Bible says Jesus looked at him. Imagine betraying Jesus and him looking you straight in your face. We betray him every time we choose somebody else over his word. We betray him every time we choose a female, fellas, over the comfort of the Holy Ghost outside of the will of God. We choose to betray him, ladies, every time you choose a man you know that's beneath you instead of the one that died to save you. Jesus was abandoned. What is the first lesson of your salvation? The walk that Jesus had to walk was lonely. He invited people to his process, and they still could not comprehend. There are certain things and moments in your life that you will come to that no matter who you invite, they will not understand. It's real quiet, and that's okay. Maybe you're just taking it in. Jesus took Peter, James, and John to the garden, but by the time he was finished praying, he was still by himself. You can invite people to your moment and they still can't walk into it with you. God will pull you away from the crowd, away from the masses and from the people you think you need to get you by yourself so that you can see him in a way that you've never seen him before. You've been around people too much. You're too distracted. You're always on your phone. You're always on social media. You always at the club. You always at brunch. You always somewhere, and that's fine. But at the core of that, you are always around people because you're afraid to get alone. Some of y'all are squirming right now because I'm coming down your street and I'm about to pull right into your driveway and blow the horn for you to get in the car. By early Friday morning, they were already beating Jesus beyond recognition. And his homeboys were nowhere around, all 12 of them. And how did he end up getting betrayed? Who betrayed him? Who betrayed him? Say his name. Judas. That's why you don't see people naming their kids Judas. Ain't nobody, this is Jeremiah, this is John, this is Josiah, that's Judas. I don't like him. I had him, but I don't trust him. Be careful what you name your babies. Be careful what you name your vision. Be careful who you let speak into your life. Be careful, because names carry weight. Girl, tell me about that man. Girl, he my everything. Careful. He's not your everything. He's not most things. He's just a couple things, and some of them things you don't need. Because all he's doing is medicating your brokenness, not promoting your healing. Jesus was being betrayed, and he got betrayed by Judas. How did Judas betray Jesus? Say it again. How many people know Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss? You kiss me to kill me? I could stay there. I could park there. It wasn't just betrayal, y'all. It was an intimate betrayal. Maybe some of y'all have never been betrayed by a close friend or a family member. Maybe you've never poured into other people and then when you needed something, they were nowhere to be found. But some of us know what it's like to have given our best to somebody else and then they just walk away. You know the pain, the anger, after you've invested years and money and time and tears. For some of us, we invested our physical bodies and then these people just up and leave. That's enough to make you hate somebody. That's why you got to get free, because they can never repay you for what you invested. So you're going to have to trust that Jesus has been accruing interest on your deposit. An 8-second praise break on your mark, get set, go. 8, 7, 6, 5. Jesus was being betrayed. His whole life, 33 years, was preparing him for a death that only he could die, to give you a life that you can only live through and in him, because in him we live and move and have our being. Who is this Jesus? And for those who have come here as visitors or guests, why should you trust Jesus? Why would you try Jesus? Some of these churches, man, I've been hurt. No. Do not mistake the gatherings of men and women for the substance of the heart of Jesus. Don't mistake goofy people for Jesus. Jesus is not a politician. Jesus is not a star. Jesus is not a social media influencer. Jesus is not a personality. Jesus is the Son of God. He was uncompromising in his character. He was loving to broken people. He is the church. And if the church doesn't look like him, then it's not the church. It's just a building that's borrowing his name. What makes Love Story different? Because I'm the pastor and I've been changed by a radical supernatural love that came to get me when I was at my lowest. Religion couldn't save me. Big time preachers couldn't save me. None of those people that I helped make millions and tens of millions and hundreds of millions of dollars could save me. Everybody left when I was going through hell and I was broken and I was trying to die and figuring out how can I kill myself and make it look like an accident. None of those people were there. And in fact, God wanted them to leave so I could just be left alone with him. And then I found out Jesus was all I had and Jesus was all I needed. Now, I need somebody to open their mouth in here. It's a little too quiet. Now, in the balcony, you ought to give God a praise, because I'm not the only person in this room that has thought about the idea of suicide because the pain was too intense. If you've been sexually abused and you're not ashamed to lift your hand, let me see. Jesus Christ, look at all of these hands of miracle survivors that shouldn't be alive. We should have lost our minds. We shouldn't know who we are. We should be filled with every disease in the book. But we in church on a resurrection Sunday giving God praise, the same body that was abused. You got my body, but you didn't get my spirit. You didn't get my soul. That belonged to... It belonged to Jesus. Every survivor, whether it was sexual abuse, physical abuse, abandonment or neglect, if you've been left by people, but you still have your mind, give God a praise. You're gonna have to come out of there. I'll go somewhere else. Stop. Yeah. I said come out of there.
But when I think of the goodness of Jesus, see, I've been through some things. This part of the service is only for those who have been through something that should have ended your life, ended your career, ended your dream, ended your hope, but somehow the blood of Jesus caught you, lifted you. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, hey, Mike, and all he's done for me, stop. We're scaring our visitors. But I can't help it. Come off that organ. My grandmother was right. He still saves. He's real. She didn't have a whole lot of formal education, but she got a revelation that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus was betrayed by those closest to him, but he still stayed 10 toes down. Because his loyalty was not contingent upon people being loyal back. Oh my God. That's how much he loved the church. And then he tells husbands, love your wife like Christ loved the church. Fellas, our commitment is not to the wife. Our covenant is to God to take care of his daughter. I'll give anything. Jesus gave everything for the church. Woo! That's a whole nother message, Pastor Lamoris. Jesus was heading towards the cross, y'all. He was going up the hill. It's called Golgotha, the place of the skull. He gets to Golgotha. Sometimes they would tie you to the cross. But when they wanted to be extra cruel, they nailed you to the cross. They say his hands, but it was actually the bone between the wrist. Because if they got you in your hand, depending on how heavy you were, the nail would slip through. But if they get you between them two bones, no matter how much you are limp, you will not fall. They want you to feel the most pain. And then they did his feet too, so he couldn't angle his lungs to get more breath. And so he's literally suffocating to death while bleeding at the same time, because they put a crown of thorns on his head. They slapped him and they beat him. The Bible says they pulled his beard out of his face, beat him with 39 stripes. It's a wicked device that they put strips, pieces of metal connected to leather, and then they would hit you on your back and it would stick to your back, and then they would pull it out to make it more painful. And they did that over and over again, and that should have killed him. But if he had died while they were beating him, then the prophecy would not have been fulfilled. So he had to stay alive to get the maximum pain, or else your salvation would not have been secure. That's why you're gonna have to excuse me, because in about 3 minutes, I'm gonna throw this mic down and give God a praise. Because when I think of what he did for me, see, if you don't make it personal, you're gonna be sitting out there looking around. You need to stop looking around and look in the mirror and look at your nasty life and look at the things you did and look at the fact that nobody can judge you for any of it, because Jesus died for all of it. Everybody who has breath in their body, praise the Lord. everybody around you did not praise the Lord. So I'm going to give them one more chance, or you can praise for them. Somebody might need a surrogate worshiper. There may be somebody that doesn't know how to lift the praise. So I'm going to need you to praise for your role. I'm going to need you to give God praise for your cousin that don't yet know how to praise. But only if God has done something for you that nobody else could do. Only if God delivered you, saved you, protected you, forgave you. This is your moment. If you got a story, this is your moment to give him glory. See, some of y'all are saying, well, I don't really understand why I'm praising. Well, let me give you a little bit more about what Jesus did. Hold on now. Come out of there. Get ready. But some of these people have yet to give God what he deserves because maybe you haven't been told the story correctly. So let me break it down for you some more. Jesus didn't have to die for your prideful behind. He could have took his toys and went back to heaven. People talk about, well, Jesus was poor. Fool, how you poor and you own the universe? He wasn't poor. He laid down his wealth and his glory so that he could become the lowest of the low. Because only if you become the lowest of the low and you already the most high can you fill all things. I need some help in here. That's why I don't like funny style churches that look at you weird if you don't have church clothes. You don't have church clothes to fit Jesus. Jesus don't fit church clothes. Jesus don't even like church clothes. Jesus wasn't for the church, he was for the streets. Put it in the chat feed. Let's offend some people. Jesus is for the streets. Some of the suburban churches say, oh my, I have never heard that in my life. What dost thou mean? Every time Jesus went to the uppity church, them Siddiqui Pharisees and Sadducees, he would go off on them, fool. Your father is the devil. Whitewashed tomb full of dead men's bones. He went off on the funny style Siddiqui acting folk. And where was Jesus most comfortable? In them streets, talking to drunk folk. The woman caught in the act of adultery, they want to throw her on the ground. Where's the man? Double standard much? Judge who you don't like, but don't judge the other one much. Jesus was for them streets. He would touch lepers and then heal them. The church wants you to get perfect and then claim you. No, don't come around once God is finished with me talking about, I'm so proud of you. No. When I needed love, when I was broken, when I was houseless, I couldn't find you. But Love Story Church, we in them streets. We where the homeless people are. We're where the orphans are. We're where the veterans are. We're where the twerkers are. Where the strippers at. Where the doughboys at. That's where I'm gonna be, because that's where the blood would be. And you go there to be an example, a contrast to the culture you're called to reach. So don't tell me that you got drunk to be an example to your drunk cousin. That's not the Bible. You walk in sober, and by the time you finish talking and being an example and just loving on them and just having regular conversation, they put their red cup down and end up coming to church with you the next day. That's what Jesus does. I'm about to get mad, Nash, because it's still a little too quiet on this left-hand side. I'm going to need some thuggish, ruggish bone praise. I'm going to need a hood praise, and I need it to start over here, and I need it to come all the way on the other side. Y'all get started. On your mark, get set. Give God glory. About Jesus, the Jesus of the Bible, a Jesus of love and mercy and forgiveness and great grace, but a Jesus that wasn't scared. He wasn't scared. He wasn't scared of devils. He wasn't scared of Pharisees, wasn't scared of Sadducees, was scared of nothing. He took that cross like a G. If this is what I got to do, my Father wants me to do this, I'm doing it. They nailed him to the cross. They put him between two thieves. They're both cussing him out. Pastor Tracy, sometimes you gotta hold your peace and let the people around you just keep acting a fool. Tell somebody, drown out the noise, praise God anyway. Tell them, drown out the noise, praise God anyway. Uh-oh. Put it in the Jeffy, drown out the noise, praise God anyway. You always going to church, ain't nothing changed. The devil is a lie. God, I thank you. Today, everything breaks in my favor. 12 hours later, it hasn't broken in my favor. It's tomorrow. God, I thank you. Today, everything breaks in my favor. You still praying the same stupid prayer. Ain't nothing changed. I bind you, it's Tuesday. God, I thank you. Today, everything breaks in my favor. See, because sometimes you got to go back 7 times till that thing shows up. Talk to me, Elisha. Jesus. Say his name like you mean it. Say it like, say his name like he one of your kids that's outside and the street lights came on and he's still outside. Jesus. The son of David. Jesus. The toast of heaven, Jesus, the first begotten of the dead, Jesus, Friday dead, Sunday alive, Jesus, King of all ages. He's between two thieves. They're cussing him out, and they say, fool, save yourself and us. And then something happened. Turn the lights off. Close the door. Turn the lights off. Turn them off. If I come back there, I know something. Turn the lights off. If you don't know how, Stacy, don't worry about it. From the 6th hour until the 9th hour, there was darkness over all the land. Pastor Charles, that's what the Bible says. There was darkness, just like it is in this room. And in that darkness, the virus of human sin was uploaded to Jesus. I need some help in here. It got dark as the transaction was being completed. The sins of the whole world were being put into the body of Jesus, his pure blood fighting against the sin of every human being. Every filthy thing everybody has ever done was uploaded to him like a virus. Help me, Holy Ghost. It was a flash drive of the demonic. Every filthy thing that we've ever done was uploaded to his blood from 12 to 3 in the afternoon. And then while he's on the cross between two thieves that are cussing him out, and now the sin of the whole world is on him, he cries out, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me? Turn the lights up in here. For 3 hours, the sins of the whole world were heaped upon Jesus. And the Bible says, Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Those were not his words. Those were the words of King David in Psalm 22. I don't have no help in here. Psalm 22, David said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not hear, and in the night season, and am not silent, but you are holy, enthroned in the praises of Israel. Imagine being on the cross, but you're reciting Psalm 22. You're saying, why have you forsaken me? But you're still holy. I don't understand this, but you're still God. I don't know what's happening, but I still trust you. They trusted in you and were not ashamed, but I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised by the people. All those who see me ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake their head saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. If you've studied scripture, people were saying that while they walked past his cross. They said, he saved others, let him save himself. If he's really the Son of God, let God come and get him. Even on the cross, he was fulfilling prophecy. Oh, you don't hear me? Go read Psalm 22. The historians believe that Jesus was literally reciting the entire psalm while he was on the cross actively dying, because this is the first and only time that Jesus was not in full relational fellowship with the Father, disconnected from his Father, sin in him. The Father's not speaking to him. And what does Jesus do? He starts reciting scripture. Somebody's about to shout right here. Jesus is on the cross. I can't feel you. I can't see you. You turned your back, but I still got a word on the inside. So even though I don't feel you, I'm a rehearse this word. I'm a recite this word. In my suffering, I'm gonna remember what's on the inside. Sometimes when God's about to graduate you, he'll remove his felt presence to see if you got enough ghost on the inside to speak that word. Because hide the word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Help me, Holy Ghost. Then Jesus has the nerve, after speaking Psalm 22, he says, into your hand I commit my spirit. That's from Psalm 31. Everything he said on the cross was the word. When you're going through your crucifixion, make sure you recite the word. When men leave you and forsake you, recite the word. When you can't feel God, recite the word, because he is his word. I need somebody who's ever been in a moment where no human wisdom could help, but you had a word on the inside. Jesus recited the word in his darkest moment. And then what happened? The thief on his right says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. I'm closing now. This ain't no long message, but I need you to catch this. A thief who was just cussing him out now says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. What happened between the suffering of Jesus, the pain and anguish of these thieves, them cussing him out? What did this thief see on a cross that made him ask Jesus to remember him? Could it be that while he was dying, his posture in his suffering was such an example. This man is on the cross dying and still quoting scripture. See, because he could hear Jesus quoting scripture while dying. He must be who he says he is if he's still quoting scripture. He's not even listening. He's ignoring my cussing, ignoring me tearing him down. He's still quoting scripture. Jesus never responded until he said, remember me. I can't get distracted by your hate and by your misunderstanding of my assignment. But when you said, remember me, I can turn to you. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. You mean to tell me I've done everything wrong? I deserve this cross. You don't deserve it. And today, after living my life my way, because I ask you to remember me, I get to go to paradise. This is for all the people who say, I never really got down with church because it's too many rules and they try to judge me. This man got converted without conversation. Wasn't no talking. He didn't get baptized. He didn't He didn't speak in tongues. He didn't join the usher board. He said, remember me. Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. He got saved not through conversation, but observation. He observed Jesus' character on the cross. He observed that even in the greatest suffering, he still quoted the word. He still kept the commandment. He observed that Jesus was Jesus in good times and bad. There are people who need to see the way you handle suffering, the way you handle trial, and your example is gonna make them know Jesus is real. I see some of y'all trying to slide down the steps. You ain't gotta go to work, but I know you're trying to get out before the rush of the crowd. But don't miss this point right here. Jesus died, but only after he had completed the transaction. He said, it is finished. Not that he was finished. It is finished. The completion of the transaction to pay for your sins is done. Nobody can add to the finished work. What happened when he died? The veil of the curtain, the temple, ripped top to bottom, which means God says everybody can come to me. You don't need 7 priests and 55 bishops to pray for you. You can pray for yourself in your car. You can pray with the weed in your hands. You can pray with the needle in your arm. You can pray with the drink right here. You can pray in the bed while they still sleep. You can pray and God will hear you where you are if you're your heart is sincere. Watch this, Manny. They died. The man on the cross died, Nashby. He opens his eyes. He's in the spirit world. Because here's what you need to know. Ain't no such thing as death. It's just transition. Your body dies, but your spirit stays alive. You better take this thing serious. They down there talking about, ooh, he looked like himself. Who cares what you look like? We care what your soul looks like. Watch this. The man on the cross who died had done nothing right except the last thing he ever did. He said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. So now they're in the spirit realm. It's some people talking about, who are you? I'm just a thief. How'd you get in? I'm with him. Somebody's about to shout. You with who? I'm with him. He invited me. Well, we see your name, but we don't see anything good you did, because that's the only thing I did was call on his name. And apparently that was enough to get in. Jesus said, no, 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 he's good. I invited him. He's with me. He's my plus one. I need you to get this in your spirit. You are Jesus plus one. He wants you to come up a little higher. Listen to me. Since he saved you, somebody just caught it. Now you need to say, who's your plus one? If you got saved, you need to go tell somebody else, Jesus is real. This thing is real. You need to come to this church. These people crazy, and they love God, man. You need to try this. The thief, converted without conversation. The companion, the crucifixion companion of Jesus. And he makes it to heaven, having done nothing right but call on the name of Jesus. You can get saved today. The process of sanctification is a choice you'd have to make. Everyone is standing. Jesus was on the cross. His blood, it said, the song said, his blood came streaming down. His blood hit the ground. His body hit the grave. So his blood hit the ground means the earth has been redeemed. So the earth has to produce harvest for you. Oh, my God. But his body hit the grave. That means I got power over the grave, because the grave couldn't hold my body, it can't hold yours. And because hell couldn't hold my spirit, it can't hold yours. If there are people in this room who need to get free from the bondage of your past, meet me at the altar right now. Because the ground is ready for you, and the grave can't keep you. If you were ever gonna give your life to Jesus, today is the day. Don't wait. Come to the altar. If you're already saved but you need a church home, come to the altar. You're the first fruit of love story. Come on down here. Who else? Somebody else needs to make a move. There he is. Come on. Walk with him, elder. Walk with him. Come on, y'all. Let's clap. I believe if you clap, they will come. More are coming. Make your move. It's no judgment here. It's only love here. It's no judgment here. It's only love here. Come on, y'all. I need y'all to keep clapping. People are moving. More people are coming. Let's celebrate them as they come. Come on, baby girl. I don't care how many tattoos you got. My wife got them. That's why I married her. I don't care if you got a nose ring. I like that. Come on. Come on. Don't ever feel ashamed. This is your father's house. Nothing can keep you from him. Jesus died so you could come to this altar right now. I need y'all to keep clapping. People are moving. Do y'all see this altar right now? Somebody in the balcony that's standing there. Other people are walking and heading towards the doors, but you need to head towards this altar. Do not leave without getting it right with Jesus. If you're online, text SAVE to 95555. Text MEMBER if you want to be a part of Love Story Church to 95555. Everybody that's at this altar, I want you to turn around. I want all of y'all at the altar to turn around. Stretch your hands out. Stretch your hands towards them like you're reaching for them. No, like you're reaching for him, like you're trying to grab him. I said the altar, not y'all. No, not like this, because y'all look like zombies. No, I want you to do like this. Everybody at the altar, look at me. Do this, like you're reaching for somebody, just in case there's another one out there. See, they're reaching from where they are, so they can bring you where they are because they made a move. Oh, y'all missed it. They're not telling you to do something they haven't already done. Is there anybody else? Y'all should tell them, come here. That's right. Tell them, come here. Oh, my God. Here he comes. See, y'all are already winning souls to the kingdom. Tell them, come on. Here she comes. Yo, yeah, tell them. Come here, man. Come here. Come on up here. Come on. Tell them, come on.
Come on. Come on. We need everybody. Yeah.
Yeah. What else you want to say?
All right.
Tell them Jesus saves.
Jesus saves. Jesus will save everybody that prays the Lord.
And he came, and we got one. Come here, my guy. Come up here. We got another one. My guy. Come here. I want you to stand here for a second. How old are you? How old? 9 years old. What's your name? Casey, 9 years old. You made an invitation, and he responded. That's a love story. What's your name, my guy? Louis. I'm about to hand you this mic, Louis, just in case you want to ask any of your other people, the homeboys or homegirls, to get to the here comes somebody else. So we got a 9-year-old that's bringing people to Christ, and he just got to the altar himself. Hold on. Hold on the music. How you doing, baby? Come here. You want to come up here? Come on. Come on up here. What's your name?
Buddha.
Say it again.
Buddha.
Buddha? I'm very glad to meet you, Buddha. Is that your family right there? Yeah. You want to stand up here with Uncle John? Can I please borrow some of your hair? It's amazing. How old are you, man of God? 28 years old. I'm about to say something that's going to ruffle a lot of feathers for those conservative church circles. But if you want a more accurate historical picture of the original Jesus, hair like lamb's wool, feet, skin like brass, he looked a lot more like this than the pictures we see. And why shouldn't he? He was created in the image of God. I'm glad he got some gold fronts, because the streets where you going are paved with what you got in your grill. If there's something you want to say, just in case somebody else need to make the move you make, I give you this mic.
If there's anybody out there that want to come up here and get their life to God, I encourage you to come up here. You know what I'm saying? I appreciate you for the service today. I honestly feel like you was really directly talking to me, not just me, but I feel like it was meant for me today. You know what I'm saying? And I appreciate you for that. Oh God, thank you. Thank you.
Proud of you, Buddha. Is anybody gonna respond to his invite? You see what he's saying. Somebody else need to make a move. We're going to wait just a few more. Uh-oh, here he comes. Look, my guy coming down. Look. Is anybody else coming? Wave at me if you're coming. Are you coming down the stairs? Is that you? Wave like we won't let the boat take off without you. Hey, one of y'all run up there and get her. She coming down. If she running this way, you run to meet her. Somebody run to meet her. Run to her. Bring her on down. There he is. Come up here, my guy. More are coming. Where'd he come? Come on up here. Whole family, come on. Let him up. Uh-oh, here's another family. Come on up. Here they come. Is more coming? Calvary, to save a wretch like you and me, that's love. That's love. Jesus went. Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's love. That's love. Hey, locks, come here. That's not how the story ends. They hung him high. Got another one. Sing it again. Look at this. Shh. I need y'all to see that the altar could not contain the move of God at Love Story Church. Today, y'all gonna have to give us a second because y'all don't know what we've been through, what we've sown, what we've given, what we've cried over to see this today. Is anybody else walking? Another one? We got another one. They hung him high. Uh-huh. Yeah. For me. Come up here. Come on. But that's not how. All of y'all. Everybody that's joining today, come on the stage. I want you and the kids to go down front right here, and I'm gonna join you. I want everybody to see what Jesus did today. I need to step out of the way. Okay. I need everybody to see what Jesus did today. Can we thank God, pastors, leaders, church for the harvest? Can we thank God for the harvest? I said, can we thank God for the harvest? All right, now Pastor Av, come on. I just needed everybody to see it without us distracting. This is the first Sunday of Love Story Church, and this is the harvest of a new anointing. No music. Hold on. I'm calling an audible. Pastor Tiffany, we're going to have to make sure we get their information. I know that we can't go into the refuel room. How many of y'all got a cell phone? Do you have it on you? You got a cell phone? You like 8 years old. If you have a cell phone, lift it up. I need everybody to text SAVED to 95555. Everybody up here, text the word SAVED. Your phone's over there. We got you. Y'all can look up on the thing, SAVED to 95555. Let me tell you how much I love and appreciate you all for standing and staying with your new family. Don't abandon them. Don't abandon them. You blessed me today. Pastor Robert, elders, pastors, leaders, I need us to do a follow-up right now to make sure that we have captured the information so we can follow up with our first harvest of Love Story Church. So I need everybody up here to repeat after me. Everybody repeat this after me. Lord Jesus, it's me. I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord. Thank you for the blood that was shed for me. I receive the free gift of salvation, not through my works, but the finished work of the cross. The blood is enough to pay for my sins. Now, Holy Spirit, come live inside and teach me how to be more like Jesus each and every day. You are my Savior and my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome to Love Story Church.
Hallelujah. Can we celebrate our family? And when service is done, if you are on this platform and if you're giving your life, you want to be baptized, you're rededicating your life, we're going to meet Pastor Tiffany and our ministers and elders right in this section. We're going to clear the youth section, and we want to see you right there where we would usually take you out to new members. But today, we're going to clear this section and have you go right there for just a few moments, okay? So we can get some information from you and to you. Pastor John, there's an invitation right here. I need you over here. If you are left in this room and you are a member of Relentless Church, if you are becoming a member of Love Story Church, let us see your hands today. If you are a member of Love Story Church, amen. Your membership just shifted from Relentless to Love Story today. Hallelujah. Give the Lord some praise.
Pastor Av, I love that. So, Love Story, have you been blessed on this Resurrection Sunday? Can you celebrate the harvest of God today and online? For those who have faith, God is still doing miracles during Easter week, Resurrection week. Get to these boards. They're around the church. Write what you're believing for. And if you came today and haven't been in a while, I'm asking you to lovingly consider coming for the next 4 weeks and see if God doesn't meet you so profoundly that your life will never be the same. Everybody throw them fours up. 4 weeks to a new life. 4 weeks to fresh revelation. How many people are going to invite somebody next week? Who's coming next week? All right. Listen, we love you. May the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord God be gracious to you, show you his favor, and give you his peace. And now unto him who was able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise God be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Amen, amen, and amen. This concludes history. Love, love, love y'all. Love Story Church. Have an amazing week. He rose. Now go eat some good food. God bless you.